policy on K-MOOC. So this afternoon, I'll just talk about some issues and factors to be considered when we design MOOC design and development related issues. Well, there are many things we have to talk about, but mainly I'm going to focus on two things in each of design and development stages. First, in design stage, target audience and objectives. Who are your target audience? For whom? And for what? That's what I mean. And in development stage, content, how to develop content and how to maintain sustainability. Well, first of all, let's talk about target audience. Sometimes we just assume that well, people out there to take MOOC. But we have to think about, again, particularly for whom specifically you are targeting, not just general public or anybody anywhere in the world. And you know that we try to kill two birds with one stone, or as a matter of fact, as many as possible. Am I right? With one stone, you can catch many birds, which much better. But for sure, we know that one size doesn't fit all. Though we try to do with one, we try to satisfy everybody out there. So we have to be very specific who should be our target. Well, for example, based on the K-MOOC, I think very similar with American MOOC and Japan and so forth, Thai, very similar. At the beginning, when you open courses, you see what demographically throughout the ages, young ones, old ones, and so forth, even teens are coming to take courses. So originally, we thought about what those college students may be the main people who are taking these courses. But when you look at statistics, again, not they are the main people. See, throughout the age groups, very diverse in terms of age. Well, again, American MOOC the similar situation like this, not just one particular age group. And in terms of the academic background, also very diverse. Even very high level of academic degrees already they've been holding. Particularly, we have to focus on many of them already have at least bachelor degrees. In other words, college graduates are taking these courses. And for what? Why do they take courses? Well, many critics, you know, that when they talk about MOOCs, they've been pointing out low completion rate. Look, 4%, 5% compared to completion rate of college. But that's very unfair, we know that. You know, there are many people out there just for curiosity come to and make registration. We shouldn't count them as a serious learners, like a college student who enroll your class. But so again, that's very unfair if you just look at the completion rate. Oh, very low in MOOCs. But that's not true. Why they've been coming and taking courses? First thing is a curiosity. What is this? No, it's free anyway. So that's the main, again, purpose. And of course, there are some serious learners out there for self-development and so forth. And also, as time goes on, if you have more courses in your MOOC site. Audience may have some better ideas what courses for fun, what courses for self-development and so forth. Not well, at this time you saw that we have just about 100 courses, not many choices out there. So as time goes on, I may see some more they've been taking MOOC for serious purpose, for more in-depth learning, but not at this time. So objectives. Well, first, why universities, even though they do not make money out of doing this, are offering courses. Even they've been spending their own money. Government funding is not enough to develop courses. So they've been putting their own money. The main reason is the bandwagon effect, you understand that, to be the one of the top five, top 10 universities which offer MOOCs through KMOOC. So we are one of the top 10. That kind of a bandwagon effect. Yes, it was true. At the beginning, it was very competitive to be one of them. But in the second year and third year, as time goes on, not much that kind of effect, bandwagon effect, unlike the first year. And second reason is that they want to experiment this new way of learning, new way of teaching. So how it'll work. So some universities and professors try to experiment this. And reputation building and brand building. Well, you know that annually, university ranking is published, and many schools, many universities are interested in seeing where the position in that list, or one of the top five, or one of the top 10, or one of the top 100 in Asia, in world, and so forth. You know that they are very now they're keen to that kind of list. But when you look at the top universities, which attract many audience learners from American MOOCs, and not the list is not equal to the traditional list of top schools. For example, San Jose University is one of the top 10 schools as far as the MOOC is concerned. So in other words, in MOOC, when you move to MOOC environment, who knows, there may be some opportunity out there. You may build up your reputation and make your own brand there. So some universities are trying to pursue this avenue. And also, student acquisitions throughout the world. They let their universities known and hopefully to attract more students. And of course, we can think of making money out of doing this. Yes, there are some universities already making money out of doing this. And actually, they've been making a lot of money, for example, Johns Hopkins, by offering data science courses. Well, it's reported that they've been making a lot of money because their courses are very popular throughout the world. So of course, there's some good chance to make a big fortune out of doing this, but not that many schools, but still, extra revenue source. And some more you can think of. So what do you try to do? Also, as time goes on, but our focus may change from one from the other. At the very beginning, just to try to see how it works, and later, to recruit students, or eventually try to make money out of doing this. But you have to be very specific. What do you want to try to achieve? And also, when you talk about MOOC, always we think that there's only one version of MOOC, but that's not true. When you say MOOC, what are you talking about? What kind of MOOC are you talking about? So I summarize, there is, to my observation, there are at least 7 different versions. But still, people say MOOC is MOOC, but that's not true. Depending on what you're talking about, because there are so many different variations here. So let's look at this first. Well, universities are offering courses through a MOOC provider like edX or Coursera or so forth. So they offer courses to the public in the form of open education. So that's the first version everyone knows. And still many people just knows this model only. Well, that's free, for example. Well, anybody can take that course. That's the first version. But we know that they start charging by offering certificates and even nano degree or specialization or series like this. And also they offer college credits of doing this to some limited extent, but still, yeah. And even they provide degrees. For example, what? Georgia Tech offers online master science degree in computer science. Yeah. Master degree offered. And college credit, for example, edX teamed up with what? Arizona State University to offer freshman level courses. So when they take online courses, they can get what? Credit for the Arizona State University and some other university if they offer, accept. Well, so far, these 4 versions are mainly for open education. But when it comes back to universities, these courses come back to universities. And they've been offered in the form of a SPOC, small private online courses, not for open education purpose, but for their own students only. Well, this is another revenue source for MOOC providers like edX, Coursera. If you approach to JMOOC or KMOOC or edX, would you allow me to use your course for my students? Of course, in that case, they'll say what? Pay me if you want to control this course by yourself. Yes, that's their way of making money. And also, we can think of what? MOOC-based flipped learning, blended learning. Yeah, upfront, we'll ask students to do pre-class learning by themselves and come after finishing that to talk about, to do problem solving, and to do face-to-face learning after that. So that's MOOC-based flipped learning. And also we see combination of between these two, open education versus private education. For the first year, you finish the first year part through MOOC. And for the second part, come to campus, that kind of model. So mix them up in this way. Well, particularly MOOC comes to private education, traditional education, then that is called residential MOOC. This is just a regular MOOC, but this one is called particularly residential MOOC. So now you see 7 different models, and who knows, there'll be some more models evolving further as time goes on. So when you say just MOOC means not one MOOC, there's no such a MOOC. in one form, many different forms. So which one you are talking about, then make a different story. Let's say, for example, look, MIT. It started open courseware movement in 2002, more than 10 years ago. It was a bold initiative at that time, open up the educational courses without charging any fees, without worrying about copyright, and anybody can use our content like this. 2002, and 10 years later, MIT come up with MOOC called MIT X. And 2015, MIT offering residential MIT X, another one. Now, residential means for their own students. Well, open courseware MOOC are for outsiders, not for my students. You understand that? We've been giving out our contents and we providing our courses to outsiders. That's kind of a contribution to the society. Social responsibility, whatever you call it. But now they've been talking about their own education. So at this point, some of you may wonder if, you know, MOOC is mainly for free in terms of cost. But as far as MIT is concerned, it's very small educational institute which charge very high price for a few elite students. So why do they need MOOC? Sometimes people wonder. So MOOC is for anybody at a very low cost, make it available, equal educational opportunity and so forth, but not for MIT students. That doesn't work. But how come for their students? This is what MIT listed, the reason why they ask their students to take education in the form of MOOC. Well, rapid feedback, adaptive thinking, flipped learning, machine learning, and so forth. So that's why I'm telling people that if you just consider the MOOC is another form of e-learning, that's not true. MOOC has its own theory, principles to pursue. They make difference from the traditional e-learning and MOOC. MOOC is not just offering course through the internet and make it available. That's not true. Even though you may not make it available through the internet, but still you have to go with these principles. Not opening course to anybody. That's not MOOC. Well, I already mentioned this, and everybody are very familiar, I think, this model, so I'll not go through this. But anyway, this is a good example. Who knows? Eventually, we'll see more and more of this kind of models. Very high quality education, but in digital format like this. And of course, MOOC teamed up with a traditional university and mix them up and offering credit courses in this way. And MIT also offers some kind of mixed model for their traditional 10-month long master's degree in logistics. It's very expensive to come and finish this course at campus. But now they divide it into two pieces. First 5 months is for MOOC. So you don't need to come and finish this. So they can accommodate many, many students, not just 30 or 40 students. As far as MOOC format is concerned, they can reach many, many students who are interested in taking this first part. And they get credit for that. And they select just a few of them, like 30 or 40, to come to campus to finish the remaining part and get the regular degree. So blending the traditional learning and MOOC-based learning in this way. And University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign, the same thing, with 2-year MBA program, first year in MOOC format, second year to come to campus. So MOOC-based education, not just the MOOC itself. Why? What do we try to do with MOOC? Well, hopefully we allow personalized learning. So individual learning can be done. At individual level, we can allow them to learn. To do this, we have to incorporate the idea of adaptive hinting. Adaptive hinting means whatever you want to do at that level allow you to go further. Or if you miss that part, try another one, something like this. So individual kind of learning can be done through adaptive hinting. And just-in-time kind of learning, not just in-case kind of learning. In other words, learn all this, then you go out and find where to use. Rather than doing that, you come up with a real need. And based on that, learn this one only or that one. You pick and choose whatever you want based on some real needs. So just-in-time kind of learning. And self-paced learning at your pace, not as a batch. Mastery learning, competency-based learning, not just to finish the course with A or B or C, but make sure that you have to meet certain criteria. So that's competence-based learning can be done. And flipped learning. Of course, sometimes we need face-to-face kind of environment, some more in-depth collaboration or discussion or idea building, so forth. In that case, yeah, flipped learning should be allowed. And global learning, not just in your area or in your nation, throughout the world, you can compete or collaborate or discuss with other learners out there. So these are the some ideas why we are talking about MOOC-based education, not just MOOC itself. So content, now the third part, the same as our online learning. Is that the same as online? Well, we have long experience in online for the last 2 decades. We have tried online learning. So we have a very clear idea of what online learning is about. So, well, particularly in Korea, even high-ranking government officers, when you talk about MOOC, they say that, oh, I know what, you don't need to explain that to me. I'm the one of them who have built up Korean e-learning this much. That's what exactly he told me, the, one of the high ministry, education ministry officer. But that's wrong. Not the same. And in most cases, in e-learning, they think that video is the main content. In other words, we try to deliver what's happening in a classroom through the internet. That's the main idea of online learning. Because of the distance, because of time limitation, they cannot take class. So we try to help them by recording what's going on in classroom and deliver to whatever they want and let them learn by themselves. That's the main idea of e-learning, to overcome those obstacles. But MOOC is not exactly for that purpose. But they think that it's the same like e-learning. The only difference is that open up or not, that's the key. They think in this way. And the reason why I put this is that Seoul National University, you know, that the number one university in Seoul, in Korea. Recently, Dean of School of Engineering announced that, and it made the big news in Korea, that we'll offer MOOC courses. We'll ask our instructors to use MOOC for their lectures. So it was a big news. So I visited his office and to understand what he tried to do. It was a very ambitious plan, so that's why I was interested in talking with him. And I visited his office, and then what kind of platform do you use? And how do you develop your courses? But surprisingly, he told me that, okay, what we want to do is that we want to record our lecture and give it to our CTL, Center for Teaching and Learning. Then they'll take care of delivery part is concerned. I don't care what kind of platform they've been using. The only thing we do is recording our lecture and let them take care of that part. How naive and how I couldn't understand what he's talking about. That's exactly what we tried 20 years ago. Am I right? Just recording what's happening in classroom and make it available. If it worked so effectively, why we we have still so many universities out there without replacing them or wipe them out if it worked so effectively? But very naive, even that level, and made big news. So as far as, I made a very brief comparison between these two. In online, video is the main thing, because that's the only way to deliver what's going on in classroom to outsiders. But when you come to MOOC, video is not the only one. 2 months ago, I went to Berlin to attend the European Conference on MOOC. One of the presenters told us that we don't have any video at all in our MOOC. It was a surprise. No video at all in their MOOC. Yeah, that's possible. Very extreme, but no video at all. Mainly what? For collaboration and discussion purposes. Well, there are two types of MOOC university, CMOOC and XMOOC. Mainly we are talking about XMOOC here, but she's talking about CMOOC. Yeah, that's very another extreme. But anyway, my point is that video is not the only thing. But many people think that video. Yeah, of course video is important, but my point is that that's not the only one, unlike e-learning. And second, the focus here is video watching. So still some university ask KMOOC to find a way to see whether a student finished watching the video or not. Because in online, there's such a feature. But in MOOC, there's not such a thing. So they couldn't understand why KMOOC doesn't provide such a feature to make sure that student finished watching that video or not. But the reason is that because for a cyber university, Korean government set such a limitation. Video should be at least 25 minutes long. So at least 25 minutes long. But when it comes to MOOC, yeah, at most it should be 6 minutes. Try to make it less than 6 minutes. So if it's longer than 25 or like 40 minutes, they get bored. That's why they want to make sure that this person has watched the entire video. But when you have a very short video, you don't need to check it. But the main difference is what? Assessment. Whether you have understand the content or not. That's the key. Rather than just whether you have watched it or not. So assessment is more important than this. And in terms of design concept, this like a make a puzzle, while this like using Lego. You understand the difference. That modular approach versus this a complete set. Even you miss one piece, that doesn't work. Well, again, online, mainly accessibility and affordability. But quality issue is there. MOOC, on the other hand, open education means competition. Through competition, we try to make sure that quality build up there. Yeah. So top quality courses. And MOOC, one advantage is automation for self-study. That's for self-study. Some people misunderstand this part. Well, computer-based learning, how come you learn things by through the computer, just watching videos? But that's the advantage, not disadvantage, because for structured knowledge, it's much easier for you to study it by yourself. That's what, personalized learning. If you know the content already, you can go very quickly. If you need some time, you have to watch 3 times or 4 times, up to you. So that's the advantage, not disadvantage. And some of these elements, like instant feedback and adaptive hinting. But still, MOOC is kind of passive. Well, you may, some of them arguable this, yes, we can do debating or a discussion and so forth. But still, it's kind of limited in that sense. That's why flipped learning, if it's necessary, should be added. And let's now talk about video. Well, here, one Korean lecturer doing lecturing here. Some instructor insists taking video in this way while doing lecturing and videotaping like this. Not just in classroom, even in studio, they've been insisting this way. Very personalized lecture-based one. This one from Wharton School, University of Pennsylvania. Very high quality university. But surprisingly, these instructors talking about in front of a camera, and while you see some students are moving around here, very distracting. I couldn't believe my eyes. You know, this guy's talking, and some people move around, even custodians moving around some things. How come we cannot find some place like this? My point is this, particularly culturally, I don't know in Thailand, but in Korea, there is some very professional video here. But in America, they doesn't pay much attention to the format itself. The content is more important than what the setting or the nice, professional-looking kind of environment. Yes, it's very important in KMOOC. That's why it's very expensive, first of all. Not just in front of camera and doing things, but it's very distracting, you see, student move around here. Well, this one, you see, just what? In his office, and with a laptop, no expensive equipment or studio at all. Just one laptop has what, a built-in camera and just talking. Very cool, some quiet environment in your office. Yeah, just recording. What's wrong with this? And some people making things like this. Or in this way. While seeing some of these different types of video, I wonder, why do we need your face? Do you need your face here? Do I need my face when I do presentation? Think about, this is a real issue. Do you need your face or without face? Yeah, when I took some of the American MOOC, instructor just comes at the very beginning for introduction purpose. No face at all since then. I don't need this face to understand what's going on. Well, my point is, depending on what you want to do, just explanation is more important than his face Or sometime, yeah, occasionally he may come up and show his face. So do I need my face throughout the video? That's another issue you have to think about. Yeah, pros and cons there. And of course, just PowerPoint, just like what you do, PowerPoint, writing and underlining, circling, and like this. And here's one of our instructors. She shared her experience in terms of video recording. She did by herself with her own camera like this. Okay, she recorded that. And we found it's a very interesting course, and she's willing to put her time. So we asked her, why don't you go to the professional studio to make it much better? So she agreed. So she went to this time professional video making company to record. And she told us that her student liked this one looks better than the other one. Of course, yeah, it's more expensive than the other one. But her conclusion is that as far as the learning experience concerned, no difference. That's the key. If you do it professionally, it's very expensive and takes much more time. She said 5 times more to make things like this rather than doing it by herself. So 5 times more time for her and very expensive to make this by professionals through contract. So time and money-wise, she said, that doesn't worthwhile as far as she's concerned. She asked her student. So that's another issue you have to think about. Yeah, make it nice, but for what? And considerations in the video recording. First, we have to think about ownership of the course. Do you own that course by yourself? What I mean is that if you offer multi-sections, not much ownership for yourself. You have to share with other instructors. In that case, you should give up your ownership. It's much better to share. So whether you have the ownership, do you keep your ownership of the course or not? That's one issue. And collaboration. Do you do it all by yourself or with colleagues? And shareability, not just in your organization, in your institute, but with some other universities. Will you be willing to share or even let them to use with certain fees? In that case, with your face or your way doesn't allow to make it shareable, easily share with others. And another issue, the maintainability. If you make it very professionally, even you try to change small things, you have to re-record. It's another very expensive solution to go through. But if you do it in a modular way, you can easily change some of the modules without changing the whole thing. So that's the issue. So division of labor, divide. Well, lecturing, you understand that in most cases we prepare the content and we deliver lecture by one person. But this time we may divide jobs with MI means master instructor, the main instructor, and the assistant instructor may need for delivery part. You prepare content while assistant instructors help you to deliver that for you and manage the course. And of course with TAs and some other supporters. So how do you divide the job? So it'd be better to manage and easier to make. And shareable, again, as I mentioned, make it personal one or impersonal one. Pros and cons there. So you have to decide. which way to go. And always you have to think about modularity. And cost justification, as I mentioned, that do it by yourself or go through a professional service. And sometimes rather than preparing content by yourself, outsourcing would be cheaper. For example, Spoke. And in terms of the course, you may ask what your student to do many things by themselves, like a peer grading rather than grading everything by yourself. Ask them to do grading. Or self-paced rather than the managed course rigorously by yourself. Just open up and let them do by themselves. So depending on how you want to manage your cost, you may think of different strategies. But mainly to reduce labor cost and your time. And revenue generation, of course, we have to think of how we can generate revenue, certificate, credit, degree, or blended learning, or corporate training purpose. Many different ways we can think of how to make revenue. Okay, I think that's what I have pretty much prepared. So if you have any question at this time, let me know.
So any questions, please?
Yes. She's very interested in doing this, and she's very good at doing it. For example, she knows how to use Camtasia and a video editing software and so forth. No. Yeah. Well, the reason why I showed you different ways of making video is that many instructors are wonders, you know, because they already know is that just recording what he or she's doing in classroom. Okay, I told the dean of School of Engineering at Seoul National University, just recording my lecture and make it to CTL to deliver that through the internet. Very naive view on video recording. That's why I want to come up with different types and to show them which way you want to do. Depending on what you do. I'm not saying just one is good for everybody. Depending on what you want to do, you want to share with others or just for your own, you have the ownership of the course or you're the authority of that subject or depending on, yeah. So those things should be considered. And you pick up what type of video you want to take. Not just, but one type of video, yes.
Rob, it's very enjoyable mm-hmm. lecture. have you ever synthesize that what is the best one to do, like how to do the shooting or how to do the video recording or the what is the best practice in each particular one, like to be the MC for the MOOC, to take the video style, if for the personal, what should be the best practice, if for the shareable, what should be the best practice? Have you sum up that kind of?
No, not yet. But again, I'm working at Nile as an advisor. So I asked them to develop some instructor's guideline. So far, we do not have an instructor's guideline because just instructors come up their own ways. So we need some kind of a guideline for them. That's why we've been working on at NIL to come up with some guidelines for KMOOC participants, you know, at least to give some ideas. Otherwise, just come up with their own ways. And then you look, go to some of those courses, just like a e-learning kind of approach. Just recording what they do in class, and no virtual no assessment at all, something like this. That's why we need some kind of guidelines at least to meet certain minimum standard. Okay.
Any more questions, please? Okay. If not,
okay,
then
thank you.
Please give him a big hand again. Thank you. Thank you very much.